Welcome to Antietam, Rebellious Generals. This is a Confederate campaign. I'm Major General Difficulty in version 1.28.4 of the J&P Mod. In the base game, many players judge their success based on their kill ratios. I don't pay much attention to kill ratios in the J&P Mod because they don't tell you the whole story, but I do consider it a success when my total casualties are less than the number of enemies that I captured. So from that viewpoint, Antietam went well. As always, thank you so much for taking the time to check out any of my materials related to the game. I hope that you find something to help you achieve success in your own campaigns. Do not hesitate to ask questions in the comments. Please be aware that Colonel, Brigadier General, and Major General Difficulties all share an AI profile. Legendary has its own profile. Therefore, things you see me do should easily translate to lower difficulties, but may not work in Legendary or be suboptimal. My career point from Chantilly went into training, so my training cap is 28, and I have 4 points per training event. However, I wouldn't fault you for using your career points from Chantilly and Weapons Factory on medicine. I'm approaching the midpoint of the campaign, where casualty numbers will ramp up with the size of the battles. 6 points in medicine is just a hair under 20% healing. That's not only 20% of your casualties restored immediately after a battle, but it also adds 20% to the 35% of the troops that move from the wounded pool to the veteran pool for a total of 55%. And it adds 20% to the 25% of the troops that move from the badly wounded pool into the wounded pool after grand battles for a total of 45%. My veteran stats are starting to look pretty good, so preserving as many vets as possible is becoming a priority. I'll use my career points from Antietam and the next 2 side battles on medicine, but you could easily justify pausing training at 6 and pumping up medicine earlier. As usual, I bought up any extra stocks of heavy guns and the better cav and skirmisher weapons before a grand battle. I spent reputation points to buy the cache of 53 Enfields, siege guns, Whitworth heavy guns, and I also took Barksdail from the officers. Deployments for Antietam are pretty simple. There are 3 phases to the battle, and 1 corps will deploy to each phase. My 4th corps is only for training and to reduce AI scaling. I will not deploy that corps. Since my 1st corps will be fighting the entire battle, it's the largest and has the best units, plus the supply wagon is full. My 3rd corps has the smallest units and only 30,000 in the supply wagon. DH Hill has the 1st corps with 2 accuracy perks and a cover perk. Ferrero has the 1st Division with Wilcox, Jackson, Siegfried, Pugh, and Rhodes. Most of my infantry have accuracy perks, but a few have a single or double melee perk. Beauregard has my cavalry division with Rowett, Hobson, Owen, Ford, and Root. Preston has a division of artillery with Cabell, Vaughn, Green, Peabody, and Scribner. McLaws has another division of infantry with Kemper, Latimer, Sedgwick, Shermer, and Nicholas. Albert Sidney Johnson has my 2nd Corps. Infantry units are 1,800 men in this corps, and I have 40,000 in the supply wagon. A.P. Hill has the 1st Division with Breckinridge, Logan, Ransom, Mahone, and Cutshaw. Evans has the 2nd Division with Lepian, Bonham, Telefaro, Drayton, and Forrest. Walton has my 3rd Division with Brooke, Coltes, Forneau, Roberts, and Doles. Garnett has my 4th Division with Perry, Standard, York, Finnegan, and Buckley. My 3rd Corps is mostly my reserve forces that fought at Gaines, Malvern, or 2nd Bull Run, so they do have some experience, except for the 4th Division. Roberts and Seams are 2 2-star units that can't take any more men without losing a star, so I placed them here. My Avatar has the 3rd Corps and Longstreet has the 1st Division, with Roberts, Seams, Barry, Farrell, and Leggett. Hood has the 2nd Division with Young, Martin, McCord, Barnett, and Gibson. Marsh has the 3rd Division with Miles, Beatty, another Miles, Hazen, and Shafter. Foreman has the 4th Division with Barksdale, Bryan, Osborne, Watson, and Brayton. The AI for Antietam is sensitive to scaling up with your unit sizes, but also for downscaling if you use small units. Without this core of training units, the AI would outnumber me 2-1. That said, I expect to win any battle where the odds are 2-1 or less, with the caveat that the AI and the player deployments happen close to the same time. For me, it isn't about whether I can win Antietam, it's about how many casualties I'm willing to take to get the victory. This training core serves two purposes. First, it downscales the AI for this particular battle, so it's about 3-2. Second, my recruit stats are high enough to start making one-star units with officers other than generals and high-level colonels. Troops with an average stat of 30 will be a one-star with even the lowest-level captain. My recruits have an average of 24 right now, which requires a low-level colonel to get them to one-star. With 8 in training, each unit can gain up to 4 points per stat, up to a cap of 28, plus the brigade officers gain experience. Some of these units will become 1-stars just by sitting in camp during the battle, and others will just be closer to getting 1-star. The AI received another full core reinforcement. Army size is down 4,000 due to the full clear at Chantilly. Training and armory numbers remain the same. The AI will have 93,575 troops and 265 guns, plus any unit splits. I have 64,512 troops and 44 guns. Not counting unit splits, the AI will have 47 infantry, 17 artillery, 3 cavalry, and 3 skirmisher units. Phase 1 is an hour and a half, and we select 11 units from 1st Corps to start the battle. All units from the 1st Corps will be on the field by the end of the phase, with the next group arriving in about 30 minutes. This is intended to be a defensive battle for the CSA, but I will selectively go on the offensive when the conditions are right. I like having a division of cavalry in the 1st Corps to help break charges and cause a little trouble. I will send some of them out to try and grab a supply wagon and maybe an artillery battery. I will anchor my defense in the woods just north of the Dunker Church VP. The Nicodemus Hill VP is not part of the victory conditions. I have no idea how many force splits Pandacrout has on the AI units here, but I see the Iron Brigade East is coming in as a split. The AI only has three dedicated skirmishers, and looks like all of them are here right at the start. Some players like to move into the center fortifications. I don't love the fortifications here, and most of the AI reinforcements seem to come in from the northeast, which allows them to set up position to flank the fortifications and remain in cover on that right side. So I'm going to stay in the wood line to the left to make the AI move into the open to attack my position. It's hard to see enemy units early in the morning, but I'll try to take this artillery battery before other units start popping up. I'll try to prick on the Iron Brigade, and maybe someone will come pursue that captured artillery. I see he's going for the artillery.
Thank you.
I do not know the AI unit deployments, so it may be a little risky having my three cavalry units in the rear here. The AI infantry are guarding their artillery, so I can't get to them yet. The AI has taken so much interest in the flanks that it has ignored attacking my center, which is where I want them to attack. I prefer that the early units come charging right across that open area so I can do more damage before they get reinforcements. My 4th Division is starting to arrive so I can build up my defense. Phase 2 is going to be a pretty good fight. I will bring 2 cavalry units over to help with charges and send the other 3 back to look at the artillery again. Since AI units are charging, maybe the artillery is unprotected. Thank you. This artillery isn't supposed to be over here. I need to get you back where you belong. With the phase about to change, I will get my guys pulled back until I know where the reinforcements will be located. Antietam has multiple alternative AI deployments like many other battles in this mod version. I hate to be too far forward and end up out of place when significant forces arrive, so I'll pull my left flank back to start this phase, at least until I know in which direction the AI forces will approach. AI forces will cross the bridge and attempt to approach the sunken road VP, so my 2nd Corps will immediately intercept them. I'll also move some of the Corps north to scout and possibly catch some of the AI forces in the open area north of the woods and the wheat fields. I'll pull Siegfried off the line to rest and replace him with Sedgwick. I'll use my skirmishers to hold these guys until my infantry can get up here to repel them. Once routing and wavering, I'll charge them. I expect the AI to recapture Hoffman, but it amuses me to make the AI work for it and see whether it will go out of its way to grab a captured unit. You're hindering your effectiveness if you're not deploying detached skirmishers in this mod version. They'll provide a little extra firepower, but I like that they take fewer casualties per volley than your infantry. With all factors being equal, the same enemy firing into your infantry is going to cause more casualties than when it fires into your skirmishers. So engaging with your skirmishers first to draw the enemy fire, then attacking with your infantry helps reduce your total casualties. This is especially true if your skirmishers can get into some cover to further reduce the damage that they take. Pleasanton's cavalry is approaching my left flank. Oh! I can see close to 6,000 horses so far. Way more firepower than my Kievan skirmishers on the far left. These AI units are in bad shape, so I'm going to run some infantry to get them closer before I have them charge. In the Union version of this battle, the field opens up larger, so forces can set up on the other side of the river rather than being forced into this kill zone before they're ready. KF tend to charge detached skirmishers with impunity, but right now mine are hidden. I'm going to turn firing off on road skirmishers to avoid revealing himself. I have no idea what the AI key ever doing here. I'm going to use these guys to try and flank the AI. Ideally, I can whittle down some of the existing forces before phase 3 starts. Has anyone else experienced this with AIKF riding off the screen? I wonder if they might reappear at the rear later on, but they don't. There's a good sized force coming down on the left. I'll get some skirmishers back out there to help and figure out how to break them up so I can deal with them a couple at a time. There are two more charging and five still coming from the left. This is going to get a little interesting. Having charge perks on some units helps. You get a passive bonus of 1/3 of the charge value, even when not charging. But the most important thing might be the reductions in morale damage to melee so that your units can last longer before they rout. I see blue dots on the mini-map that have not yet come into view. I will assume that this is Slocum's division. This is exactly how I like to fight. My guys are in cover, backed up by their artillery, and the AI is all in the open. The left side appears to be under control now. I'd like to take out a few more guns on the right side, but I think the AI has them well protected. Stonewall Jackson has been killed at Antietam, 8 months earlier than he was in real life. Smith's division has been spotted, and it looks like they are right on top of my skirmishers. Oops. Let me see if I can manage around this. I expected to flank from the right to the left before the last phase started, not deal with guys spawning in here right on top of me. I have one detached skirmisher on the left taking on two brigades, and a few on the right taking on multiple brigades. Kind of amusing. Oh well, at least they're keeping the AI occupied, so not everybody's pressing my center at the same time. My detached skirmishers are screwed, but I can probably get some other units over there to take out most of these guys. There's Franklin, so another corps must be coming in from the northeast. I will do what I can with this group and then pull back before the next phase starts. My infantry on the left flank should be fine with just artillery support for the rest of this phase, so I'm going to send my cav out to eliminate the AI forces around Nicodemus Hill. I will attempt to push the AI out of the right side. One more infantry and a dedicated skirmisher is on this side to clean up. Wine and Logan stopped charging. He must have lost line of sight to the target. Thank you. I don't know how many units the AI gets in Phase 3, but the Union Army's looking a little sparse. I wish I had time to take out several of the artillery batteries on the right before the phase changed, but I think I'll need to wait. Phase 3 is potentially 4 hours. In the Union version of the battle, units do not assault at Burnside Bridge until about 30 minutes into the phase. However, here in the CSA battle, Burnside is deployed right away. If Burnside's units do not appear at the bridge when the phase starts, that an alternative deployment has occurred and he'll be somewhere in the north. When that happens, there's no reason to leave units in the south and you can send everybody north. I'm going to send out detached skirmishers just to take a look for unit forces, but I'll be sending most of my 3rd Corps to the north to get into the fight. I will pull my units back to the line on the right flank until I know where the AI forces are coming from. I'll form a new defensive line and prepare to flank hard once I'm confident all the AI units are in place. However, I will send Forrest and Cutshaw out to try and take some supply wagons. Forrest is the fastest unit that I have due to having dual charge perks. He can track down supply wagons very quickly. I have Colties providing covering fire for my retreating units since many of them are tired and are starting to slow down. I don't want to get into a fight right here. I want the AI to move towards their objective and close in behind them. Assuming the AI units are headed towards the sunken road, VP, I'll send units across the bridge, run up the right side, and then cross back over the bridge to flank the AI. The downside of not having six in recon is not knowing how many troops the AI still has on the field. I'm checking for any straggler artillery or supply wagons that I can get before starting to surround the AI in the center. There's infantry here. Forrest is wounded. I should be able to take this one star with just my melee cav. I'll have all three fire their pistols until it routes and then I'll charge. Thank you. Hopefully, I don't get Siegfried or Pew killed bringing them out this way.
Thank you.
I'll have my CAF finish this unit and then flank the other two from the rear to help out my infantry on the left flank.
Thank you.
The AI is mass charging now because I thinned out my line, moving units around on my flanks. That makes it conclude that it has a high chance of success with a jailbreak blitz. I had 2,699 men killed, 8,073 wounded, and I have 1,192 missing, for a total of 11,964 casualties. The AI had 50,035 casualties and 17,745 captured. There's the cav that left the field. My cavs had some pretty good kills. My first core units to start of the battle have the most kills by far. I had many promotions, but I noticed that some of my dead officers are not listed. Stonewall Jackson should be listed here, but he's not. Thank you so much for spending some of your valuable time watching today. I hope you found something useful for your campaigns, and I wish you much success, Generals.